Although it may seem as though it was a two-horse race between the USA and the USSR, from the mid-1950s, a small club of nations, one by one, gained the ability to independently launch satellites using their own rockets. And in chronological order, they were the Soviet Union, United States, France, Japan, China, and the United Kingdom. Whilst the Americans and Soviets threw billions of dollars and rubles and the power of the state at the problem of space, the British, after the Second World War, were almost bankrupt and shadows of their former industrial might, but they still had the brains and wanted a seat at the top table of the New World Order. The price of entry to this exclusive club was a nuclear deterrent, as the US government refused to share information about the atomic bomb, on which many top British scientists had worked to develop. Britain knew that it would have to develop its own bomb and missile delivery system to match that of the Soviets and keep up with the US. Britain's heavy missile blue streak had been in slow development between 1955 and 1960, but costs overran alongside growing scepticism from the British government. 2 years later, the Nassau Agreement between the British Prime Minister Harold Macmillan and John F. Kennedy confirmed the sale of American Polaris missiles instead as Britain's ICBM launch system. Rather than waste the millions of pounds and years of development that went into the homegrown rocket technology, the British government approved the development of Blue Streak into a satellite launcher called Black Prince. However, the cost would be significant, and neither the UK government nor any member of the Commonwealth would help fund the programme. With the risk of Blue Streak going unused, British Aviation Minister Peter Thornycroft approached the French government in 1960 and offered the rocket as Britain's contribution to the new European Launcher Development Organisation, or ELDO. Blue Streak would serve as the lower stage of a joint satellite launch system called Europa. Britain's rocket engineers were back in business, and Blue Streak began testing in 1964 at Woomer, South Australia. The remote test site covered a vast area, over 47,000 square miles or 122,000 square kilometres, over half the area of Britain. Blue Streak flew 10 times from Woomera until 1970, but in 1971, after a failed launch and review, the rocket was retired to be replaced with the French Ariane design. But Britain's dream of an independent orbital capability was not forgotten. Some hoped that Woomera would grow to become a Commonwealth spaceport, perhaps one day launching joint UK-Australia missions to the moon and beyond. Back in Britain, the engineering firm Saunders-Roe, later Westland, and Bristol Siddeley, bought out by Rolls-Royce in 1968, still had contracts to develop a smaller launcher that would be compatible with the ELDO lower stage. The project was named Black Arrow, following the Ministry of Supply's convention of rainbow codes, assigning a colour and a noun to research programmes. Black Arrow would be as much a technical demonstrator to show the viability of the HTP kerosene-powered engines developed for the Black Knight as it was a potential commercial launch system. The rocket would burn 85% high-test peroxide, or HTP, and kerosene on the two lower stages, something that the British had perfected, and would use a solid fuel third stage to deliver a small satellite to orbit. HTP was originally developed by the Germans in World War II for bipropellant rockets like the Walter HWK-509 in the Messerschmitt ME-163. High-test peroxide is the same as people use to bleach their hair blonde, but instead of the 2-4% concentration for hair bleach, HTP is between 70-98%. Although not as reactive as some of the other oxidizers like hydrazine, it is one of the easiest to handle. It doesn't give off poisonous fumes, and if spilt, it can be washed away with a hose and water, but it will still set fire to or explode anything organic it touches and is liable to spontaneous combustion at temperatures above 150 degrees Celsius. Black Arrow played to British strengths. HTP fuel technology had already been developed in experimental British submarines and torpedoes. The fuel also has the advantage of not requiring cryogenic storage and all the extra handling and insulation that goes with it. Very convenient for launches in the hot Australian desert. It is also energy dense. Liquid hydrogen takes up 17 times the volume for the same given weight. This makes an HTP rocket much smaller and cheaper to make. As a bipropellant fuel mixture, HTP is hypergolic, meaning that it ignites on contact with kerosene when decomposed in the engine, removing a potential point of failure, namely the ignition of the fuel, and it will ignite in space where there is no oxygen. It also produced a very clean exhaust plume. Static firing tests took place at High Down on the Isle of Wight, where Saunders-Roe were based. From here, the rocket was shipped to Woomer Rocket Range for the first demonstration flight on the 27th of June 1969. Codename R0, the first launch carried a dummy payload, but on launch, some of the rocket vectoring nozzles started to rock backwards and forwards, causing the rocket to go into a roll oscillation. It reached around 9,000 feet before it was destroyed by the range safety officer. The second test launch, R1, was almost a year later, on March 4, 1970. For the first time, the fairing was painted bright red for visibility, earning the Black Arrow the nickname the Lipstick Rocket. This time, the first and second stages worked exactly as planned. On the 2nd of September 1970, Black Arrow had its first chance to deliver a working satellite into orbit. R2 would carry the Orba satellite. Built from spare parts due to the project's shoestring budget, Orba was a 13-kilogram or 29-pound sphere containing an instrument to measure atmospheric density as its orbit decayed. However, during the launch, the second stage shut down 13 seconds early, and Orba burned up on re-entry. Black Arrow would have to wait another year for its next launch. The R3 rocket carried a satellite that was to be named Puck, after the nimble wanderer of the night in the Shakespeare play A Midsummer Night's Dream. It weighed 66 kilos or 146 pounds and was designed to test a variety of satellite systems and detect micrometeorites in low orbit. As the R3 rocket was en route to Australia, the British government announced the surprise cancellation of the Black Arrow project for so-called economic reasons. However, behind the scenes, there were other issues. NASA had offered their Scout launcher for future satellites for almost free, although this offer was later withdrawn after the cancellation of the Black Arrow, and the R2 failure had sowed doubt regarding the Black Arrow's reliability. The lack of resources and infrequent testing also slowed down development to a crawl. There was also little in the way of any commercial prospects. In 1971, there was no satellite business as we know it now. It was too small to launch many of the larger satellites of the day, and miniaturization of the electronics still had many years to go before commercial satellites would be small enough to make use of the Black Arrow. Also, it seems in order to placate the French with their own Diamant launcher, later to become Ariane, the British Prime Minister Edward Heath, in secret talks, offered to cancel the Black Arrow project after the UK joined the common market, suggesting that neither the UK nor the French had any further use for the Black Arrow, and effectively removing any competition for the European launch system. On being told that this would be the last launch, the team changed the name of the satellite from Puck to Prospero, another character from Shakespeare, this time the sorcerer in The Tempest, who gave up his magical powers, a typically understated British riposte to the government of the day. Black Arrow took off for the last time on October 28, 1971, and made it into orbit with a textbook launch. As Prospero was released, the solid fuel third stage bumped and damaged one of the four communication antenna. However, the satellite functioned as intended and remained in radio contact with the British tracking station in Lasham, Hampshire, for 25 years until 1996, when its mission was officially concluded. R4, the final Black Arrow and backup for the R3, was never flown. It and a spare Prospero satellite are now preserved at the Science Museum in London. The X4 satellite, which was due to be launched on the R4, was put into orbit by an American Scout D1 rocket in March 1974 from the Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. The Black Arrow was ahead of its time. If the government had decided to continue, much like the French did, it would have been well placed for the launch of the later smaller satellites as the communications industry grew and would have kept Britain in the space race. Since 2000, the government has looked at resurrecting the programme, but too many of the original personnel with the expertise have died and the facilities dismantled. Whether anything in the near future will arise remains to be seen. Ultimately, Black Arrow was one of the most economical launch systems ever developed. Because the system used the technology developed for the earlier Black Knight, the total cost of the Black Arrow program, including research and operations, was just £10 million, equivalent to around £65 million today. Just a little more than NASA pays for one seat on the Russian Soyuz to the ISS. And as for Prospero, it's expected to orbit until around 2070, when it will fall back to Earth to end its 100-year journey. So thanks for watching, and I'd just like to say that this episode's shirt is the Penny Dot Lane in purple by Madcap England and is available at atomretro.com with worldwide shipping from here in the UK. Don't forget we also have the Curious Droid Facebook page and group. The link is in the channel page, and you can now also translate any of the videos with the community contributions. I would also like to thank all of our Patreons for their ongoing support, and if you would like to support us, then please click on the Patreon link now showing. So as always, thanks again for watching, and please subscribe, rate, and share.